The Disrupt Education vlog can be found on YouTube. To hear it in podcast form, search Disrupt Education on any of the following podcast platforms: Anchor, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Breaker, Castbox, Overcast, Radio Public, Pocket Cast, Spotify, or Stitcher. Welcome to Disrupt Education. Today's guest is Michaela Foster Marsh, who is the author of the book Starchild, a memoir about Michaela's life with her adopted brother Frankie and Michaela's journey to learn about Frankie after his tragic death by finding his birth family in Uganda. Michaela is an acclaimed musician with not just one, two, but three albums to her credit, and the founder and executive director of Starchild Charity. She lives in Glasgow, Scotland, and has received a Prime Minister's Award for her work in Uganda. Michaela, thank you so much for joining us with our crew on Disrupt Education.
Thank you. Thanks, Peter. Thanks for having me on.
Oh, let's jump right in. Let's dig a little bit deeper into who you are. I'm gonna let you expand on that introduction, if you don't mind. Who is Michaela?
You did such a good job there. I don't know what's left for me to tell. I'm a singer-songwriter, and more recently, I guess I've been doing a lot of writing. And as you say, the memoir has recently been published. And lived in Toronto and Ottawa, and that's where my music career was. So I obviously grew up in Scotland, in Glasgow, and then immigrated to Canada and ended up working in the recording industry as a performer. And so I did that for many years, and also spent about 6 months in New York. And travelled a lot with the music, various venues and things. And then ultimately I ended up coming back to Scotland. My heart, I guess, was pulled back here. And I have lived and worked here for, since 16 years I've been back here now. And I'm doing a lot more writing. I guess the songwriting, there just wasn't enough room on the page. I wanted to expand and write a lot more. So... And before that, I had studied fashion design at college, so it's always been something creative. I've always been in the arts. I wasn't academic at school and always drawn, so my whole life has been revolved around some kind of artistic expression of some sort. It's just that more as I've got older, I think the writing seems to be the one big passion that has not left me and the one that I work the hardest at, I think. Yeah.
So let's dig a little deeper into that education, because I love the fact that you're like, I'm not like a traditional student, I'm a creative. What was that like growing up? Did you go to school? Was it in Scotland? And what was that path like being a creative in education?
Difficult. I was called stupid at school, and I would have said that I had some learning difficulties. I certainly wasn't an A student. I was usually the bottom of the class, and that was always pointed out. And, you know, I did have some rough times at school. I don't have happy memories of school. A diagnosis of dyslexia did not happen till I was about 40. It's mild. I mean, I can read and write, but I definitely, you know, had struggled at school with this, and I had no idea at that time that's what it is. I was. And so I think that... that has really given me an empathy for children who have some learning difficulties, challenges, and really why we started a school for creative arts in Uganda, because I knew myself just how important that was, and if it had been missing from my life, I don't know what I would have done. I think at school there was arts programs at least in our primary and secondary school, and I knew that I excelled at those things. And thank goodness, or my self-esteem would have really been in the toilet, so to speak. I really did need that. But it wasn't overly encouraged at school. But I was fortunate that I had parents, and my father in particular, who really didn't put any pressure on me to achieve academically. I think that he knew that I just was never going to be an academic type student. And so he encouraged my creativity in life and didn't put it down, and gave me every opportunity to express that creativity. And thank goodness that he did. So it wasn't that I got rewarded at school for creativity in any way, but rather the opposite, that I felt, you know, the pressure was on to be academic, and I wasn't. So yeah, that I found challenging, but really that has shaped my life now and how I work in Uganda and why I do what I do and why I'm so passionate about it, is because I had my challenges at school myself. So there's one particular teacher that really did call me out and call me stupid in school, and I spent a lot of time being angry at her. And now I actually thank her. I think she was maybe a gift in my life to some degree, because when I was in Uganda, I really recognised the pain of some of these children simply because of that incident that happened to me in the classroom in Glasgow, with an unsympathetic teacher who obviously had no concept of what it feels like not to be so academic and clever in the class. Yeah.
Yeah, that's an amazing thing to really understand and try to forgive and move forward. And that's a blessing for all of us. There has been a lot of change going into the humanistic approach, and I think we're evolving in education. But let's take a step back. There, you had a brother, Frankie. And the book is all about this, and you know, going deep into Frankie and your mission to find his family. That's how you got to Uganda. Tell us a little bit about that learning path, and then what you are doing now with your experiences, because you have built or are building a school in Uganda. Yeah, take us down that journey, if you will.
Well, it was 18 years after Frankie's death. I mean, we were brought up as twins. There was a month between us, so we were extremely close. It was very unusual to see a black and a white child pushed around Glasgow in a twin pram. Mm. At that point, transracial adoption was literally unheard of. Mm. And when Frankie died, as I say, 27 in a house fire, I was devastated, the saddest day of my life. Mm. But 18 years later, it took 18 years to finally go to Uganda. And I miraculously, as I say in the book, I did find his family. And I was overwhelmed by not only the fact that I suddenly overnight had three new brothers, African brothers, I was also overwhelmed by the level of poverty. And I really felt I wanted to do something. And so when I came back home, I started set up the charity Starchild, and we initially wanted to build a school. And it morphed once I was there, and I actually saw, like I say, just that there was no arts programs at all for these children. And the children that were failing, I really, I remember saying to a teacher one day what was wrong with the child. There was a child there that was really, you know, very sad and lonely looking and an outsider. And the teacher just said to me, well, he's just stupid. And I said, how do you know the child's stupid? How do you know if you put a guitar in his hand or a paintbrush in his hand, he's not going to be Picasso, or, you know? And she said to me, well, I'm not going to get the child's hope up. I don't even have money for pencils, let alone paintbrushes. And she just dismissed it. And it was at that point I left feeling really sad. And it was a reminder of how I felt. And I said to my partner, Ronnie, at the time, I said, the more I think about this, I don't think we should be building a school. I think we should be building a school for creative arts, or trying to bring the arts to these schools, because the focus was all in academia. If you asked a child in Uganda what they wanted to be, they would all say, I want to be a doctor, a lawyer. You know, if you ask a kid here, they'd probably want to be, you know, a reality TV star, or they want to be a musician, or, you know, they want to do the, you know, the arts, whereas in Uganda it's the complete opposite. They all want to be, you know, academic. Mm-hmm. and with the best will in the world, these kids are not going to be. First of all, they're not got the money, the families don't to put them through university or college or anything. So there was a real lack of vocational training, and there was a real lack of the arts programs. So when I came back home to Scotland, I said to our board, I really think that we should be focusing on the arts, and it's what I knew. It had taken a while for it to dawn on me that this was really what I should be doing in Uganda. And they went along, and they went along with this and agreed. They felt, yep, this is what we're going to do. And so I don't want to go into all the boring details. Well, they're not boring, but the details of how we actually achieved that. But that is in the book. But really, I just felt that the arts was definitely where we were heading. And so we ended up, we did build a school for creative arts, and it was a first of its kind. And now other schools, what's happened is that there's competition. So the other schools have thought, oh, we better start to get sewing machines and get arts materials in here, and because otherwise the kids will all come to our school and not go to their school. So exactly what we wanted to happen has happened. So it's had a snowball effect. So the other local schools have started to introduce arts programs to compete with our school, which is great. I'm all for that, because now other children are accessing the arts and vocational training. You know, we do teach sewing and things like that, where they can actually perhaps get a job and make a living from it. Mm-hmm. The kids that are particularly not even going to even go on to secondary school. So that gives them an opportunity. And then fast forwarding from that, we are now working at building a holistic centre for children affected with autism and disabilities, because in Uganda, the myths and stigmas associated with them are absolutely horrendous. Mm. So something else has now morphed out of all of that, because from our own school, I learned very quickly that we could not get the most marginalised into our school, meaning children that maybe had disabilities and autism, because the myths and stigmas were so horrendous. Mm-hmm. So I started to look at what we could do to make it accessible for these children, or to build a separate unit, because they don't even want to touch these children. Mm-hmm. But then we could try and bring about some form of inclusion. So I started to work with a school here that has a center for autism and disabilities, well, mainly autism, called the Communication Support Service Group at William Wood High School. And they have a fabulous unit there. And they have a much more holistic approach to education. They have a sensory room. You know, they have they teach yoga, meditation, things like that for these children that have autism. And I mean, as far as I'm concerned, that should be in the mainstream school. Yes. You know, I wish it was in the mainstream schools. And maybe some schools do, but there's no school that I know, not over in Scotland at the moment, that is doing that. But certainly with the autistic children, they've recognised that this is very important, and that they need that downtime, decompress. They need their little tent space. And they go into some forms of meditation. And like I say, when I went there and I saw them doing yoga, I thought, this is brilliant. I mean, I do yoga, I do meditation. I need that. Yeah, but if I'd had that at school, what a difference. And also we're now trying to create them a space, like a nature space outside, which again is so important. And nature teaches us so much. Mm. We can learn so much from nature. So what we're trying to do is kind of mirror their ideas and work alongside that and create our own ideas and bring that now to Uganda. So we're building a holistic centre in memory of my partner, Ronnie, who died last year. Mm. So we're going to call it the Sunflower Sanctuary, and it is going to encompass all of those things. So we'll have all of the sensory, educate them about autism, about disabilities, but also use a lot more of the, you know, the spiritual maybe, you know, just not much more holistic approach to the education. And I would like to see us be able to use that out with the school, just, you know, the autism unit, that we could actually use that in the school. You know, I think one of the things that I have really recognised, the difference is the dichotomy between the children in Uganda and here, is there is such a huge increase. I don't know what it's like in America, in the States, Canada at the moment, but here, the mental health has, and the suicide rate has increased dramatically in the youth. It's there's a huge rise in it. Mm-hmm. And Yet in Uganda, these children are up against huge social economic problems, and you don't hear about children committing suicide or having mental health issues. And that what the pressures on some of these children are enormous.
Yeah.
They are maybe walking, they're up at 5 a.m, they might have to walk up to 7 kilometers sometimes to get their water. The pressure for them to get an academic education is intense, it's huge, because the family do put that pressure on them. That's why I wanted to introduce the arts, even if it's just an escapism.
Yeah.
Because that, again, the arts is such, I mean, it's, to me, it's an internal necessity to create. You know, I couldn't live without that creative process and being able to do that. So the pressures on them to achieve academically, just to get to school, the financial impact on the family, they feel responsible for that. You know, and like I say, those social economic problems there are so huge. The chores they have to do, they've got large families, they're involved in the cooking, the domestic life. When they go home, they have to do all of that. They're having to clean pots, there's no dishwashers. And yet, you don't hear the children complaining.
Right.
And they don't have the same mental health. And I'm thinking, what is creating that imbalance that the children here, who are being, some of them, lifted and laid to school that maybe don't even know how to cross a street? I mean, I hope I don't sound like I'm exaggerating, but do you know what I mean? Like that they're, you know, they're mollycoddled and taken to school back and forward, and yet these kids are walking barefoot for their water.
Right.
What is creating that dichotomy? Why are the children there relatively happier than the children that are here? So I'm not an expert in that. I'm only speaking through my own lens and what I'm seeing. And I'm thinking, wow, what is it? Where have we gone wrong?
You know,
is it the education system, the parenting? What, you know, again, I'm not judging anything, but I can see, looking at both countries and looking at the education systems in both and what's happening, problems on both. Neither is perfect. But the one thing that stands out to me is that the children in Uganda seem to be a lot more at ease with themselves and happier. The children here seem to be hooked onto their phones and their computer games, and they're not out in nature the way these kids, even if, you know, I think to myself, I've had to do a lot more walking, not had to do, but I've done a lot more walking since COVID. And I've been out in nature and how healing that is. And I think, is it the 5 kilometer, 7 kilometer walk to the water that calms them? You know, like, you know, you just have to think about all of these things and then think, what, where are we going wrong and what can we do to change it? Again, I'm no expert. I'm just speaking about the things that I've witnessed.
I feel you're on to something, though, and I feel in the States as well, there is a sense of distraction. Obviously, we're also experiencing a lot of the digital world and people being, you know, pulled from reality. And it's interesting. I'm putting together a program with my other business right now, and it is go outside, be with the trees. If you are in an urban area, try to get somewhere where there isn't a lot of streets and cars and noise. And I believe we have something to learn in the holistic approach. And it is a transformation. I think there's hope outside of what is happening with COVID and you know, the story with you building the school and working with these young individuals in a struggling nation is something that we can and should learn from. So I really believe that.
Another thing that we are doing at the moment is they have a big garden, and we're teaching them how to plant and do all the horticulture and things like that, which again is taking you back to nature. And some people find like gardening and things like that so therapeutic. They're having to grow their own food. I mean, we're doing that at the school because it saves money, and we're also teaching them a life skill. So, you know, and again, you know, the center here for autism, I don't know how big the garden space is going to be, but the idea of getting them to actually have their own food you know, to plant their own food, things like that. These are so important. And here, okay, we don't have to do that. In Uganda, they do to some extent, but the earth is so fertile. We don't have that fertile earth. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you stood in the ground and you grow, I mean, they are very blessed with fertile land that we don't have. But there is still something very healing and nurturing. And I just think that, you know, looking in to the education system, I just wonder if there's a place for a more holistic approach and things like that, and taking the kids much more out into nature and even learning much more about the cosmic charms and you know, things like that, like a collective consciousness and you know, I think the great thing, I mean, I'm thinking about Greta, you know, what is it, the environmental woman, Greta Stomson, mm-hmm. What? Yeah.
I
mean, the kids have really latched on to her.
Yeah.
As a kind of peer, kind of, you know, it's really interesting how they've become so involved. It's as if that's given them a voice, something to get involved in that maybe they haven't been listened to.
Yeah.
Tomsberg. Yeah.
Yes.
To give the kids something that they feel connected to, and that seems to be environment and healing the planet.
Mm-hmm.
And I just think she's so brilliant, and she's autistic. Mm-hmm. I mean, isn't that,
right.
You know, it's wonderful. And I think I'm trying to think, why do the kids of today, why have they latched on to her? What is, you know, and I think that it must be something to do with that. They feel collectively that they're being empowered in some way.
Yes.
And yet until she's come along, that there's been a disempowerment. We've not been listening to that generation.
Mm-hmm.
And they have been so stuck in their phones.
Right.
But if you take something like that, it's given them a platform, something that they feel useful in society, that they can get their teeth into. And I think that's missing. And she's brought that to the forefront.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe we need to think about those things as well. I don't know. These are just things that are coming as we're talking. You know?
Absolutely. And no, it's a great conversation. I feel very strongly about student voice and young people's voice, bringing them into, if you had, I mean, think about back when we were in school and those troubles that we were having. If there was a space where we could feel comfortable and safe to vocalize the things that were happening to us that we just didn't feel right about, and possibly suggest one or two different ways to do it and be heard and actually have action behind it. I think that's what you're getting at. I that would actually help me, I know, because I was not the best student as well. And I did see educators, unfortunately, you know, bad mouth, if you will, students and make them feel bad because they weren't academic students with that. So much to learn in the holistic way. What is next for you? What's next with the Starchild charity, and how can people give and give their time or any kind of assets to Starchild?
Well, the next thing really is our center. We are hoping to build this center. We had wanted to go back to Uganda in July to put the foundation of for autism in place, and obviously with COVID, we've not been able to do that. So everything has been kind of put on hold. Uganda, the schools only went back, and they've gone back staggered at the moment, so the situation there is pretty rough, and you know, there's no way we can get ourselves there. But as soon as we can get back, the centre will start to be built, and we will start working on getting the trainers and getting some people from here. So also our School for Creative Arts, we're always interested in people who want to kind of partner or come and be at the school or lend their talents in the arts. You know, whether it's musicians or painters or people who might want to spend some time working with the kids, we're open for all of that. You know, I think, again, in a country that is developing, your arts, that these are the ambassadors for the country. I mean, with the best, you know, I don't, no offense to engineers or anything, but people don't remember who built a road, but they remember the beautiful painting. They remember who created the dance or the music. So I think it's really important for the country, you know, countries like Uganda, to invest in arts programs, because these are your ambassadors. Mm-hmm. And we are interested in ambassadors from other countries coming and learning about the arts in Uganda and the culture in Uganda, and marrying the two and learning about each other's culture. Mm-hmm. So I'm really open for all of that sharing of knowledge and inspiration, and the kids get really inspired by that. So definitely we want to move in that direction with our own school by inviting other people to come to it. And the same with the autism for the Holistic Centre. People who have ideas who might want to work with us out there. Obviously, any donations are more than welcome. We're struggling like all charities. But if you're asking about people's time and energy, that's just as important. You know, you can't put a dollar figure on that. And so they can access us really easily through the Starchild website, starchildcharity.org, or my own website, Michaela Foster Marsh, Michaela Online. I'm very accessible, and obviously so is the charity, and really open to ideas about working with children with autism. I am not an expert. I have learned just simply by going along to that school and getting to know some of the children. We did a DVD about autism, and it was just to show in Uganda that these children have a worth. Mm-hmm. That just because they might think slightly differently and you know, process things slightly differently. So we had the children there basically do the fill on themselves, which was a great creative process and a learning process. So I'm a visual learner, so mm-hmm. I like to create projects where you can learn visually.
Yes.
So that's what the kids did in Uganda. I'm not in Uganda, here in Scotland. And they still talk about that project. They just loved being part of that film. It brought them out. And it was a two-way street, because we were able to then take that to Uganda and let the people in Uganda see that these children are incredible and well worth investing in. Every child, like our program is finding the star in every child. And I think that every child does have a star there. It's up to us as the adults, as a teacher, to find and nurture what that quality is. Everybody has something that's special and unique. And, you know, I just wish at school there was a few teachers that I had that were fabulous and really encouraging. But, you know, there's the ones that just, you know, put you down, and they're the ones that you have a much harder time forgetting about, unfortunately. You know, I just want to encourage teachers and parents to be able to look at their child and find the star in them, find what it is that they're good at.
That's a wonderful way to look at it. I couldn't agree more. As an educator, there is something very special about finding the star in a child and helping them grow that. I think that's at the heart of education, why an educator becomes an educator, and what a wonderful way to put it. Michaela, I want to thank you so much for being with us on Disrupt Education today, and we will put all your contact information so people can reach out as well. But we really appreciate you being here today.
Oh, thank you, Peter. It was really nice to speak to you. And it's a great program. What you're doing is fabulous, so keep doing it.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you all for checking out Disrupt Education today. If you get a moment, hit that subscribe button. Drop us a comment. We're here to change education for the better. Thank you.